Thank you, choir. It's wonderful to see you here today. We're looking forward to a great day in the house of the Lord. We just completed our ladies' conference, the Central Texas Ladies' Conference. Nearly 300 ladies here this weekend, and delighted in all that God has accomplished through this meeting. We're thankful that you're here today. Let's all stand together, may we? We're going to ask God's blessing, invite His presence, His Spirit here. I hope that you've come with a heart that needs to be filled with something other than yourself. It needs to be filled with God, God's Word, with God's help. And I pray that God's Word will get in today as we consider this Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry of our Lord Jesus Christ. This would be what would be known as the beginning of the Passion Week of Christ. It was this day that Christ would have ridden in and begun. He does some teachings. I've got a seven-part series of sermons that I want to bring to you over the next seven times we meet together, and I pray that God will use it. Tonight we'll be considering hearing Jesus. Today we're talking about parading Jesus as He rides in triumphantly. But then He comes in and He has a message for the people, and He gives some great teachings between now and the time He is crucified. On Wednesday I'll be speaking about killing Jesus. Now, that's quite the title, isn't it? And something for us to consider. And I imagine that in all of our lives, we've done this. Some way, somehow, we've done this. And I want to encourage you to be here and be a part of all this. I'm looking forward to all that God wants to do through this series of sermons. I pray that you'll be right involved in all of them over the next seven or eight times we meet together. We're looking forward to it. Of course, next week is Easter Sunday. We'll be celebrating Jesus. And then in the evening, our young people will be leading the service, leading all the music, singing. The youth choir will be singing. Our young men will be preaching. Ladies will be playing the piano. It'll be a great time. There's some folks giving testimony, and it'll be wonderful. I hope you'll make plans to be a part of it all. So many things are happening this week in the life of our church. Tomorrow we begin a special time of prayer, a 24-hour prayer vigil. It begins Monday at 6 o'clock. I hope you've signed up for that. It continues all the way through Tuesday. On Wednesday, we'll observe the Lord's Supper together here and the Wednesday evening service. Make plans for that. Thursday and Friday is our Belton Bible Days. This is where we take the church outdoors at the Yeti Poke Park in downtown Belton. This is our county seat. We're just going to go. We're going to sing. We're going to preach. We're going to encourage folks. We're going to be a witness. And we're praying that God will bless in a great way. I hope you'll be a part of it all. And then, of course, we'll meet together next Sunday for our Easter celebration, where we'll be remembering the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hope you're part of it all. Let's go to God in prayer. Let's ask His blessing on this meeting. Dear Heavenly Father, we need You. We're looking unto You. We're living by faith. And we want to continue to live by faith. Help us, Lord, as we begin this journey with You, as we think about this idea of parading Jesus. And Lord, I'm glad You rode in that day. I pray that You would help us as we take a look at what this declares. And may we all walk out of here rejoicing, knowing that we've set our eyes on the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one, the only one that can forgive sins, the only one that can make us right with You. God, now we pray in this hour. May You be glorified through it all. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You'll find our hymn book under the seat in front of you. If you'll turn to hymn number one, we're going to sing together, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Today is this Palm Sunday when He rode in. People paraded the Lord and they rejoiced and cried, Hosanna, King of Kings, King sent from God. Let's do this today, this morning, if we could, as we crown Him with many crowns. Hymn number one.
Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing as thy matchless King through all eternity. tomb. Crown him the Lord of love. Behold his hands and side. Rich wounds yet visible above. In beauty glorified.
Glory
in the sky. And fully bear that sign.
When we see Christ, it will be worth it all. Let's sing it out on that first verse.
Oftentimes the day seems long, our trials hard to bear. We're tempted to complain, to murmur and despair. But Christ will soon appear to catch his bride. Trials will seem so small when we see Christ.
Would you share with someone right around you just for a moment? We're not going to move our seats. Maybe someone you know and love. Maybe someone you don't know and love. But will you share with them something that you, while you were singing this song, you're thinking about your burden. You're thinking about how we can lay it down at Jesus' feet and we can trust the Lord with it. Will you share that with someone? Let's just take just a moment. Pianist will play. Let's just take just a moment. Share a burden that you can bring, that you know you can bring to the Lord and lay it at His feet. Wonderful. Good. 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 We'll give you 10 more seconds. Everybody's doing it. Sound booth, ushers, everybody's sharing a burden. Good. You can lay at Jesus' feet and trust Him. This is why I know. Amen. Good. Wonderful. He is all we need. Thank you. You can make your way back to your seat. And let's have a seat together if we could. The choir is prepared to sing. Here's what I'd like to do before the choir sings, if you could help me with this. Our ushers are working diligently trying to find seats that are available. If you have one seat next to you that you know is empty, ushers, if you would, stand and take a look. If you have one seat that you know is beside you, because as guests come in, our ushers are greeting them, and they're saying, let me help you find a seat. And then they're going to that seat, checking to make sure that seat is available and empty, not with Bibles, filled with Bibles. And all that. And then they're going back and getting our guests and bringing them to the seat. If you have one seat next to you, would you raise your hand? Good. If you have two seats next to you, would you keep your hand raised? If you have three or more seats next to you, would you keep your hand raised? Good. We're looking at it. If you have four or more, good. Are you seeing this, ushers? This will help you. How about five or more chairs? Very good. Wonderful. I think we've found the solution. Good. And so now, ushers, you know where to take these folks. You know where the available seats are. Let's make sure we help folks when they come through the door. What a great problem to have. We're working at it. We're hearing from our contractors and developers and engineers about this balcony renovation that needs to take place. I want you to be praying. It's already there. The structure is already there. The risers and all the stairwells and all those things still need to be developed to help us through it all and exits. To the restrooms and the balcony and all that. We're working at it, laboring. We're looking forward to hearing all about it whenever we get the opportunity to do so. And so help us, that God would give us wisdom in all of this. Wonderful. The choir is coming to sing. It's a message. It's entitled, We Preach Christ.
Church, the chosen bride of Christ. We have the imprint of His cross upon our lives. The highest price was paid when the Lamb of God was made, the perfect and most holy sacrifice. We have one purpose, one mission, one reason to remain, to raise the cross of Jesus and magnify His name. We preach Christ, who was crucified and risen from the grave. We preach Christ, the only one who has the strength to save. We proclaim is the power of His name.
truth today, and of this truth we will never be ashamed. Though many doubters rise and reject the claims of Christ, God's unchanging word will still remain. We have this moment, this hour, to seek and save the lost,
to speak the name of Jesus and point them to the cross. We preach Christ, who was crucified and risen from the grave. We preach Christ, the only one who has the strength to save. The message we proclaim is the power of His name. We preach Christ, so we lift the name of Jesus for all the world to see. The message of salvation to all who will believe. We preach Christ, who was crucified and risen from the grave. We preach Christ, the only one who has the strength to save. The message we proclaim is the power of His name. We preach Christ, the only one who has the strength to save. The message we proclaim is the power of His name. We preach Christ. We preach Christ. We
Thank you so much, choir. There's nothing greater to talk about than our Lord Jesus Christ. We have a lost and dying world that needs to hear His name. Thank you. Our men are here with guest cards in their hands. If this is your first time with us, we're so thankful you're here today. As our men walk to the back, we get their attention. They want to put one of these cards in your hand. If you haven't already got one, will you get one from them this morning? And then if you would, take that and fill it out for us. And then in just a few moments, we're going to have the offering. If you would, put that in our offering plate. That way we have a record of your visit. We're so thankful that the Lord would bring you here to worship Him with us today. As we did just a minute ago, we're going to fellowship. This time I'm going to ask you, especially church members, greet our guests. Let them know we're happy to have them here. Let's all stand together and let's greet one another and talk about Christ this morning.
make our way back to our seats. We're on page 346. 346 is Christ is all I need. Christ is all I need. We'll sing these couple verses. Christ is all I need. Christ is all I need. All I need. Christ is all I need. Christ is all I need. All I need. He was crucified. He was crucified. That a true statement?
Amen.
You may be seated.
No doubt about it. Would you take your Bible along with me if you would, please, and let's go to the book of Numbers, the 19th chapter, Numbers chapter 19 for our Bible reading this morning. We're walking with the children of Israel as they're learning the Lord and discovering how God works. We're in Numbers chapter 19. We're supposed to be in Numbers 17. Is anybody else there? 18 it is. That's right. 18 it is. That is where my marker is. Numbers chapter 18. Very good. When those you love that are nearest you lead you astray. No, I'm teasing. They do a wonderful job. Wonderful. Numbers chapter 18 in verse number 1. We're walking with the children of Israel and God has been at work in their lives. He's teaching them about murmuring and complaining. He's helping them. They're wandering in the wilderness. They had been a people in slavery, but now they are no longer. They're learning to become a nation, establishing leaders and leadership. God is doing all of this. He desires to be their God, and He desires to be their King. And we come now to Numbers chapter 18, and let's read, if we could, in verse number 1. The Lord said unto Aaron, thou and thy sons and thy father's house with thee shall bear the iniquity of the sanctuary, and thou and thy sons with thee shall bear the iniquity of your priesthood, and your brethren also of the tribe of Levi, the tribe of thy father, bring thou with thee, that thou may be joined unto thee and minister unto thee, but thou and thy sons with thee shall minister before the tabernacle of witness, and they shall keep thy charge and the charge of all the tabernacle. Only they shall not come nigh the vessels of the sanctuary and the altar, that neither they nor ye also die. And they shall be joined unto thee, and keep the charge of the tabernacle of the congregation. For all the service of the tabernacle and a stranger shall not come nigh unto you. Ye shall keep the charge of the sanctuary, the charge of the altar, that there be no wrath any more upon the children of Israel. And I, behold, I have taken your brethren, the Levites from among the children of Israel to you, they are given as a gift for the Lord to do the service of the tabernacle of the congregation. Therefore, thou and thy sons with thee shall keep your priest's office for everything of the altar and within the veil. And ye shall serve. I have given your priest's office unto you as a service of gift. And the stranger that cometh nigh shall be put to death. And the Lord spake unto Aaron, behold, I have also given thee the charge of mine heave offering of all the hallowed things of the children of Israel. Unto thee have I given them by reason of the anointing unto thy sons by an ordinance forever. This shall be thine of the most holy things, reserved from the fire, every oblation of theirs, every meat offering of theirs, and every sin offering of theirs, and every trespass offering of theirs, which they shall render unto me, shall be most holy for thee and for thy sons. In the most holy place shalt thou eat it. Every male shall eat it. It shall be holy unto thee. And this is thine, the heave offering of their gift, with all the wave offering of the children of Israel, I have given them unto thee, and to thy sons, and to thy daughters with thee. By a statute forever, every one that is clean in thy house shall eat it. And the best of the oil, and the best of the wine, and the best of the wheat, and the first fruits of them which they shall offer unto the Lord, them have I given thee. And whatsoever is first ripe in the land, which they shall bring unto the Lord, shall be thine. Every one that is clean in thine house shall eat of it. Verse 14. Everything devoted in Israel shall be thine. Everything that openeth the matrix in all flesh, which they bring unto the Lord, whether it be of man or beast, shall be thine. Nevertheless, the firstborn of man shalt thou surely redeem, and the firstling of unclean beasts shalt thou redeem. And those that are to be redeemed from a month old shalt thou redeem, according to thine estimation, for the money of 5 shekels, after the shekel of the sanctuary, which is 20 gerahs. But the firstling of a cow, or the firstling of a sheep, or the firstling of a goat, thou shalt not redeem. They are holy. Thou shalt sprinkle their blood upon the altar, and shalt burn their fat for an offering made by fire, for a sweet savor unto the Lord. The flesh of them shall be thine, as the wave breast and as the right shoulder are thine. All the heave offerings of the holy things which the children of Israel offer unto the Lord have I given thee and thy sons and thy daughters with thee. By a statute forever, it is a covenant of salt forever before the Lord unto thee and to thy seed with thee. And the Lord spake unto Aaron, thou shalt have no inheritance in their land, neither shalt thou have any part among them. I am thy part and thine inheritance among the children of Israel. This is God caring for his servants, for the priests. He's saying, you're not going to have any land designated to you. I will be your part, and I will supply your every need. Verse 21. And behold, I have given the children of Levi all the tenth in Israel for an inheritance for their service, which they serve, even the service of the tabernacle of the congregation. Neither must the children of Israel henceforth come nigh the tabernacle of the congregation, lest they bear sin and die. But the Levites shall do the service of the tabernacle of the congregation, and they shall bear their iniquity. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations, that among the children of Israel they have no inheritance. But the tithes of the children of Israel, which they offer as a heave offering unto the Lord, I have given to the Levites to inherit it. Therefore, I have said unto them, among the children of Israel, they shall have no inheritance. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, thus speak unto the Levites, and say unto them, when you take of the children of Israel the tithe, which I have given you from them for your inheritance, then ye shall offer up a heave offering of it for the Lord, even a tenth part of the tithe. And this, your heave offering, shall be reckoned unto you as though it were the corn of the threshing floor and as the fullness of the winepress. Thus ye also shall offer a heave offering unto the Lord of all your tithes which ye receive of the children of Israel, and ye shall give thereof the Lord's heave offering to Aaron the priest. Out of all your gifts ye shall offer every heave offering of the Lord, of all the beasts thereof, even the hallowed part thereof out of it. Therefore thou shalt say unto them, when we have heaved the best thereof from it, then it shall be counted unto the Levites as the increase of the threshing floor and as the increase of the winepress. And ye shall eat it in every place, ye and your household, for it is your reward for your service in the tabernacle of the congregation. And ye shall bear no sin by reason of it when ye have heaved for it the best of it. Neither shall ye pollute the holy things of the children of Israel, lest ye die. Wonderful. Everyone is responsible to give unto the Lord, even those that minister in the tabernacle. And God cares for His own, doesn't He? And those who will serve Him will never go without. And God is so wonderful, and He's so faithful. He's faithful to every one of His children. We praise the Lord for His order and for His teaching. We had a wonderful ladies' conference here yesterday. God blessed in a mighty way. We do have some books available. One of the speakers that was here is an author, and she has her book. We've put it in the back of the auditorium. If you're interested in purchasing this book, you can do so. Somebody will be there at the conclusion. The title of the book is On Purpose, On Purpose. And this book teaches how God makes children. He makes them on purpose. He makes them specifically. And this is a battle. We're in a battle, aren't we? We're in a battle for the hearts and minds of children. And we're in a spiritual warfare. And the devil is working diligently. And God's people, too, must work diligently. I would encourage you, if you have children in your home, or if you have grandchildren or great-grandchildren or children that you know and love, that you care deeply about, purchase this book for them and get it in their hearts and minds and help them, help them. It's beautifully illustrated. It's beautifully done. It teaches them how God made them, how He cares for them, how He has a purpose for them. It shares with them very simply the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you can take this and teach it. There's scripture verses on every page. There's a concordance in the back of every scripture that is used. The children can use it as a Bible verse. There are, I believe, 12 to 15 different parts to this book. And you can take them and use them and teach them. Some of you are teaching children in Bible studies and Sunday schools. You can take this and use this as a 12 to 13 week series to teach these children and help them memorize the Bible and to hide these truths in their hearts. It's a wonderful resource. I hope you'll avail yourself of it, make use of it, and let God be glorified. I'm asking our men to come, if they would, be prepared to receive the offering this morning. I appreciate our men so much, working diligently. What a blessing. I'm going to ask Brother Salyas, if he'd come, lead us in our prayer. He has in his hands one of these books. It's beautifully done. I want you to see it. Thank you so much. This book, On Purpose, and you'll find them right in the back of the auditorium here. And beautifully illustrated, of course, for children. And I think you'll make great use of it, how everyone is different, but God has made them all, and He cares for them. He's made them boys and girls. He's made them short and tall, and He's made them all. And it's beautifully illustrated through different types of eyes, of course, different sizes. You're very special to God. I hope that you'll take it. We didn't swing from monkeys. We were created in the image of God. It's teaching about creation. And I hope you'll get it and use it in your home. Josias, lead us in prayer if you don't mind. God bless you, sir.
Lord, as we pray, we just thank You that Your mercies were yet again new this morning. Lord, that You never fail. We thank You for this ability to come amongst Your people and praise You and sing these hymns, Lord, of truth, that You are all we need. Yes. Lord, I pray in this moment that You'd help us soften our hearts and open our hearts and ears, that we would not just be hearers of Your word, but also doers, as Pastor comes and preach what You've given him for us to hear. I pray that You'd fill him with Your Holy Spirit. I pray now also that You would please help us to give according to that which You've asked us to give, Lord. I pray that You bless it. For all it's in name, most precious and holy, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Wonderful. Well, Miss Ashley Johnston's coming to sing. Before she comes, we do want to say, Brother John White, it's been a joy to have you as part of Northside Baptist Church. This is his final service with us today. He will be PCSing on from here on Tuesday, I believe that's the case. But it's been a joy to have you. God has used you, and particularly used you in this young lady's life. Yeah. Brother John is a twin. His brother David came to visit John. And by God's divine appointment, Miss Ashley Johnston and David White saw one another. Stars appeared. Heavenly voices rang. Yeah, they were mesmerized. Magnetic attraction happened. And now she bears a ring that is a promise. Yes, there it is. Yes. That bears that she has spoken for. And I believe they're supposed to be united in marriage in August. And so be praying, if you would, for her and for Brother David. And, of course, be praying for Brother John as he continues on the service to our God and to our country. That God would lead him along. Appreciate him so much. And glad he's here. He comes from a great family. And God has great plans for him. Before I come to preach, Miss Johnson's coming to sing. God bless you.
God picked up a sparrow that could no longer fly. He brushed off his wounds and then watched it soar into the sky. If he's mindful of creation, on this I can depend. I am his child, and I can place all my trust in him. I can trust you. Kept right on trusting in his word. My wants and God's desires don't always agree, but I lean on his will, for he always knows what's best for me. Trust you. Jesus, he takes care.
Take your Bibles with me, if you would, please. We're going to the book of Luke. We'll be in the 19th chapter together. Luke chapter 19, I'd like for us to consider the thought of parading Jesus. Parading Jesus. When we think about a parade, I think all of our minds go to maybe the 4th of July parade or a Christmas parade or some kind of special parade where we present something and we all gather around it and we applaud it and we cheer it and we rejoice in it. It is a presentation of something great. It is something that we all know and recognize and we all revere. We look at it, we would parade it down the road and people would gather around and we rejoice. Sometimes we throw things at it, and flowers, and we have the Parade of Roses in California that's before one of the large football games. And they would throw flowers and parade flowers. Oftentimes it's people that are parading, that are being paraded. They would cast candies and treats and information packets out as they are something that everyone needs to know about and look at. This is what is happening with our Lord Jesus Christ. But can I say that it was a unique situation? And I think it's important for us to consider this triumphal entry of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's necessary for us to consider. On our calendars, we call this Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday, in reference to when the people took the palm branches and laid them down in the roads and took them and waved them at the Lord. And so we call it Palm Sunday. This all is meaning something. This all is something. Let's read together, if we could, this account of our Lord Jesus Christ. We know His ministry has begun. He began His earthly ministry when He was 30 years old. He has been now to Zacchaeus' home. He has told Zacchaeus to come down out of the tree. Do you remember? Because I want to go to your house today. And Zacchaeus' life was changed. He said, boy, I've done a lot. I've given a lot of, stolen a lot of stuff. But boy, everything I have, I'm giving back. And I'm going to give more than I ever took. And God changed his life. And he's in the business of changing lives. Amen. Now he's coming. And we come to this 28th verse. In Luke chapter 19 and verse number 28, the Bible said, when he had thus spoken, he went before, ascending up to Jerusalem. Now the reality is, the Lord is not, if we were to look at a map, he would not be moving north. Oftentimes when we say, come up here, or go down there, are you coming up, are you going down? We'd be speaking of north and south. But this is about elevation. He's going up to Jerusalem, which is a city set on a hill. He was going up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass in verse 29, when he was come nigh to Bethpage and Bethany, this was on the east side of Jerusalem, somewhat northeast, at the mount called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, go ye into the village over against you, in the which at your entering ye shall find a colt tied, whereon yet never man set. Loose him, and bring him hither. And if any man ask you, why do ye loose him? Thus shall ye say unto him, because the Lord hath need of him. At this time, the Lord's name was certainly popular in that area. Jesus had performed many miracles. He taught often in the temple. And people knew who Jesus Christ was. They knew who he was. Many had followed him, become his disciples. Some were part of the inner circle. Some were part of those that followed, maybe not too far off, that were beginning to learn the teachings of Christ and who he was and what he declared himself to be. And then you had some that were the skeptics. They were following the Lord to try to catch him. They were following the Lord to try to, maybe they weren't all in. They were trying to discover if they wanted to give their lives to the Lord and to follow him. And some were just onlookers. And then, of course, within this crowd, you had some Jews. There were Pharisees and Sadducees and scribes and lawyers, people that were trying to catch Jesus. They wanted to hear him say things like he is the Son of God, because they would declare that to be blasphemy, that no man can declare that he is the Son of God. But we know that Jesus had the power to do that because he was the Son of God. They're looking to catch him so that they can kill him. They want him to be rid of him. Why? They're losing money like crazy. As Jesus is taking disciples and he's making disciples, then people are no longer going to the Jewish synagogues. They're losing their crowd. And they're upset with the Lord. They're losing political position with Rome. the concern about what's going on. And in their culture, you remember, they were under Roman rule, these Jews living in Jerusalem and all around. They were under Roman rule. They did not have full rights. They were citizens under Roman law. And really the Romans, we could say they put up with them. They allowed them to have their religious activities, but they had taken a lot of the authority away from them. These Pharisees and Sadducees, these that were part of the Sanhedrin, this Jewish governing board and decision makers and lawmakers, they didn't have full authority. They could not put people to death under Roman law. They would be guilty of murder. They had to have Roman authority to do so. And so they're trying to catch Jesus. Here, we're learning all of this. The Bible says that Jesus had said, you need to let them know that the Lord hath need of them. Verse 32. And they that were sent went their way and found even as he had said unto them. And as they were loosing the colt, the owners thereof said unto them, why loose ye the colt? And they said, the Lord hath need of him. And they brought him to Jesus. They cast their garments upon the colt, and they set Jesus thereon. And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way. And when they were come nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that he had seen, saying, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of these Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And he answered and said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. What's happened here is Jesus Christ has made a triumphal entry from the east side of Jerusalem. He's come. And we know that we're looking, as God's people, we're looking to the eastern sky. We're waiting on the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. But here he comes from Bethpage and Bethany, entering in to Jerusalem upon this colt, this donkey that a man never sat upon. This, of course, is given to us in the Old Testament. It's prophesied, and we'll dig into that in a little while. But here he comes riding in. As he's riding in, his followers see him riding in, and maybe some of them are remembering the Old Testament scripture, and they're knowing exactly what they're supposed to be doing. Some of them are excited that Jesus has come. It's time for the Passover, and here comes Jesus, our great master, our great teacher has come in, and we want to follow him. This would not be unique for the Jewish people. For many of these Pharisees, they would have these parades or these people that would follow them, oftentimes every Sabbath. As they would make their journey into the synagogue or into the temple, they would have an entourage of people that would follow them. For these Pharisees and these Sadducees were great religious leaders. They were also wealthy. It's even been known that many of these Pharisees and Sadducees would pay people to come out and to parade them, to follow them. And it showed as they arrived to the synagogue, this great entourage of people bearing with them as these people are my disciples. These are my followers. These are the people that I work with. They're parading these Pharisees and Sadducees. This is why you see them in the temple, you remember, making much of the offering that they're giving. They had trumpet people who would sound the trumpet. People who would go, oh, when he would give his great offering. You remember the Lord rebuked that? He said, you see this lady here that just has a few mites? What she gave is greater than what they gave, because she of her want gave all she had. But you're giving out of the resources and what you have left over. But this lady is trusting me with everything. In other words, the Lord was saying, this big entourage, this big to-do about your offering is nothing in the sight of God. Boy, God rebukes them. It would be normal for great crowds to assemble, but this crowd that assembled around the Lord Jesus Christ, they were parading him. They were taking these palm branches. They were taking their clothes off and laying it in the road, making a red carpet, so to speak, for the Lord as he made his way in near the Passover, near these feasts that were to come. And he's coming, and they're saying, our leader, the one that we follow, is coming to town. Now, some other things that would happen during this Passover time. Of course, these Jews that would come from all around the world for these feasts, the city would swell. Here on April the 8th, I think they're warning us, aren't they, about this solar eclipse, and they're telling us to stay off the roads, and they're telling us to prepare for emergency phone calls and those types of things, that cell phone towers may be overwhelmed. I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to prepare you for all of this. They're saying if you can, stay home because the roads will be crowded. They're saying if you don't want people parking on your grass, you may need to prepare your home that way. I'm trying to help you and guide you, right? We're expecting it. They're saying that our city is going to double in size that weekend. If you're trying to fly out, be prepared for all of that because it is an absolute chaos. My wife and I will be flying. She'll be speaking in a ladies' meeting. And I'm looking and I'm wondering what in the world is going on where we're going. It's not what's going on there. It's what's going on here. And people are trying to get out of here to go home. And tickets are astronomical. And so it's all happening. So the city of Jerusalem would swell as people would come ready for these great feasts. Well, of course, when that happens, the city is alerted. Rome itself is alerted. They're preparing emergency responses. They're preparing possibly for uprisings. They're concerned because people, when they come into Jerusalem for these feasts, they're bringing their own tents and they're bringing their own dwellings and they're bringing their own animals. Boy, the city and the markets are all overwhelmed. And so merchants are coming in. They're making sure that people have their permits and their licenses to sell. All of Rome is awakened that the Passover is going to take place and the Jews are coming to Jerusalem. And so, of course, you know what else is happening? It is not just these Pharisees and these Sadducees that are parading in. It is also the Romans that are parading in. They're making sure that their presence is felt and that their presence is known. Just like our community leaders and our police and our fire departments, they're all prepared and they're all readying us and they're all positioning themselves for all this. They've had community meeting after community meeting about this solar eclipse that's coming to us here on April, I believe it's the 8th. It's all coming to us, and they're making their presence known. Well, Rome is doing the same thing. When Jesus rides in, he's riding in as an authority. He's coming in, not quietly, but he's coming in, shall we say, politically. He's coming in and he knows what's going to happen and he prepares this entourage and his heart and his mind, and because he is God, he knows all things. He has a colt and a donkey prepared. And he's preparing and he knows that there's going to be a great crowd that follows him into Jerusalem. And he's going to make, not only is he going to make a religious statement for all of us to study and to know and to prepare us for what he's about to face going to the cross in his great trial, but he's also making a political statement. As we consider parading Jesus in this parade of the Lord, the parade of Christ declares Christ as the final authority. I want you to notice with me, as we read here in Luke chapter 19, we've discovered in this 38th verse, it says that the people said, "Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest." This King, he comes in the name of the Lord. They're declaring that Jesus Christ is the final, he is the ultimate authority. That Jesus Christ is coming into Jerusalem, and they're not considering Rome in this. They're not out for the parade that Rome is making with all their white horses and their big attire on top of their heads and all their weapons. These people are following Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is declaring himself as the ultimate authority. He is superseding the Sanhedrin, this Jewish council. He is superseding the political parties of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He is superseding the law of Rome. And he's riding in and he's making his grand entrance in, and he is declaring himself, and his followers are declaring him to be the King, the one sent from God, the great King, the final authority. He is declaring himself as God of all the earth. Wow, what an entrance he's making in as he's making his way. And all the Jewish world is there. And Rome is gathered. And Rome is aware of the statement that Jesus is making. And no doubt that story is going to make its way throughout the military ranks. It's going to make its way in the governmental houses. And it's going to make its way right to the very one who thinks he's the greatest authority in all the world, the emperor of Rome. And Jesus is going to declare that he is the final and ultimate authority. Now, how do you think that rang in Rome? Ah, not good. We know the end, don't we? They crucified him for his statements, for his political statements. Boy, when we start thinking about this parade of Jesus, there's something to it, isn't there? Yes, it declares that he is the final and ultimate authority. The second thing it declares Jesus Christ as the King of the Jews. As King of the Jews. Where do you get this, Pastor? Well, we declared here that these Jewish people that were following the Lord, they blessed the king in verse 38, and he cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Notice verse 39, some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. Of course, they're concerned not only about the political, but they declare him to be the king, the one that cometh in the name of the Lord. These Jews did not believe that Jesus Christ was the Messiah. They were upset that Jesus Christ would allow his followers to say that he was coming in the name of God, the name of the Lord. It's oftentimes we refer to Jesus Christ as the Lord Jesus Christ. But here, this is talking about the Creator God, the God in heaven, the one that made all things, the ultimate authority. And they're saying, these Pharisees, these Jews are saying, Jesus, how can you allow them to give you that title? You cannot allow them to give you that title. This is blasphemy that you are allowing them to say that you are coming in the name of the Lord, that you are God, that you are the King, the ultimate authority. They're upset with this, but Jesus is allowing it. He says if they don't say it, the rocks are going to cry out and say it because the whole earth is prepared for this moment. Oh, Jesus, he'd forever with his disciples has said, mine hour is not yet come, mine hour is not yet come. You remember when they tried to get a hold of him and he was able to escape through the crowds and they didn't capture him and they didn't take him? He would say, mine hour is not yet come, mine hour is not yet come. But now, you know what the Lord has said? Mine hour has come. It's time. This is it. Anybody can say anything they want to about me regarding me as God because I am God. Oh, it made them mad. You say, how did all that work out? Well, I'm glad you asked. Jump over to John chapter 19. We're in Luke, so you go to the next book to the right in John chapter 19. And we'll discover how it all went. We know that this is the end. Jesus Christ has now been crucified, or he's preparing to be crucified. Jesus has been tried. You remember, he went, he answered not a word. The people, the Jews, have an opportunity for Barabbas to be released or Christ to be released. Pilate is wondering. He's trying to give Christ an opportunity to speak for himself, to get out of the trouble because he knows that Jesus has done nothing. He's concerned about it all. He doesn't want to crucify Christ. He even states previously, when Jesus answered not a word, he says, don't you know that I'm the one that can release you? I'm the one that can save your life. And Jesus said, you couldn't do nothing if my Father in heaven didn't give you permission to do it. Notice in verse 14, the Bible says, and it was the preparation of the Passover, about the sixth hour. And he saith unto the Jews, this is Pilate coming. He saith unto the Jews, behold your king. He's brought Jesus out on the porch. And the crowds are all gathered, the ones that cried, crucify him, crucify him. Free Barabbas, crucify Jesus. And he brings him out. He's bleeding. He's wearing the crown of thorns. His back is beaten. And he says, and Roman power, with Roman authority, as a mock, he says, behold your king. And notice what the 15th verse says. Those Jews, those Pharisees, those that were there, Verse 15 says, but they cried out, away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate saith unto them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, we have no king but Caesar. They denied God and they accepted only the authority of Rome. And they said that he is their king. Jesus, in his triumphal entry, declared that he is the king of the Jews. We know it to be true because it bothered these chief priests, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Jews. Do you remember when Jesus Christ was crucified? Do you remember the inscription they put above his head? King of the Jews. You remember there were some Jews that were upset about that, and they came to Pilate and they said, look, change the inscription. Not that he's the king of the Jews, but that he declared himself to be the king of the Jews. He's not our king. And Jesus said, oh, I am. I am your king. I am the king of the Jews. The third thing we see in this parade, this triumphal entry, if we go back to the book of Luke, we would see, stay right there in John. We'd see through this parade that it declared Christ as the Savior of the world. Not only did it declare that Christ is the final authority, it also declared that he's the king of the Jews, but he also declared that he's the Savior of the world. You know what the word Hosanna means? They cried, Hosanna, Hosanna, it comes in the name of the Lord. It means save now. Save us now, save us now. Oh, there was a political cry to that because they were under Roman rule. These that were followers of Jesus, they wanted him to get his kingdom set up. Do you remember? Even the disciples before Jesus ascended, when are you going to become the king? When are you going to usher all this in? And he said, it's not for you to know the times and the seasons, but you shall receive power after that. The Holy Ghost has come upon you, right? Remember? You'll be witnesses unto me. Yeah. Everyone was interested when Jesus was going to take his earthly throne. But it wasn't the time for that. It wasn't the time for that. Jesus was the Savior of the world. But it wasn't the time for him to take his earthly throne. There was a political cry that Jesus, this is his grand entrance. This is when he's going to set upon his throne and he's going to rule on earth and he's going to overcome Rome. Oh, some of his disciples no doubt wanted that. Don't you want that? Amen. I want that. I want for Christ to come and I want him to reign. No doubt about it. I want God's will to be done. I'm looking forward to that day. They wanted freedom from Rome. But Jesus was also declaring that he's the Savior of the world. Save now. Save now. Do you know that God is in the saving business? Amen. And Christ came to save you from your sins. And you know what he can do for you now? He can save you. He might not be able to save you out of your bad work environment at this moment. He may not be able to save you out of a bad marriage. He may not be able to save you out of a bad financial situation at this moment. But you know what he can do? He can save you from condemnation and damnation eternally in hell at this moment. He can save you from your sins. He's the Savior of the world. Matthew is a book that's written to the Jews. Do you know that as you study this, it does not say that Jesus is the king of the Jews? Because that would be offensive to the Jews. So it says that he is king and he is the son of David. That ties in the Jewish thing. You come to the book of Mark when you read the account of the triumphal entry. You know what he's coming as? He's coming in the face of Rome because the book of Mark is kind of written with a Roman mind and a Roman mindset. And he's coming and he's coming in and he's dealing with things how he is the king of the Jews. But he's not offending so much the Romans, although he is stating who he is. You come to the book of Luke, it's written to the Greek mind. And the book of Luke, God deals with a number of things. I wish we had time to deal with it, but he's coming. And he's coming as man, and he's presenting himself as man. But you know what happens when we come to John, the book of John, and we find the account in John? We find that Jesus is presented as the Son of God. He's the Son of God. It's not a political issue that he's dealing with. It's not a matter of trying to convince you in your mind that he's dealing with. He's trying to present himself as the Son of God. He's coming in the name of the Lord. the name of God, the name. He emphasizes. You remember how John begins the book of John? John chapter 1, what do we learn? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus Christ is the Word. He's presenting Himself as God. He's presenting Himself as the Son of God. And when He comes in the book of John, He's coming in the name. He's coming in the name of the Lord. In other words, He's got all authority and all power. He's coming on God's behalf to you, and He's able to save you now from your sins. You know, your greatest need is not, and my greatest need, and America's greatest need, and the world's greatest need. You know what our greatest need is? It's not some great world power to come in and rescue us all. It's not for some great economic schemer to come in and create some one world cash system or something, some cashless system. That's not the great need of this world. The great need of this world is not for some political leader to jump up or some great political leaders. Oh, I praise the Lord for some of our political leaders and our Secretary of the House and all that. I praise the Lord, but you know they're not our Savior. They're not the ones that can produce our greatest need and fulfill our greatest need. The one that has the power to rescue you from your greatest need is Jesus Christ. Amen. And He can save now. Oh, He came, and we'll discover, we'll talk about tonight as we're hearing Jesus, we're going to hear some of His lessons about the future, and we're going to talk about some of the discourses He had on the Mount of Olives with His disciples and some of the teachings that He gave to them, and we're going to see what He did and who He is and what we must learn from this. But the greatest thing you can ever learn is the gospel. That is that Jesus Christ came as the Son of God. He became man without ceasing to be God. He was perfect. He never sinned. You and I don't have that ability because we're from a sinful stock. I'm a sinner. I was born in sin. I was born of a woman in few days, Job said. We're full of trouble. We're all sinners. Jesus was not. He lived perfectly. He had no condemnation on Him. But man killed Him because He declared Himself to be the Son of God. They didn't like Him, but He came. He presented Himself for us. He gave Himself for us. He died on Calvary's tree, and He bore all that to pay our penalty. You see, because the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And that comes through Jesus Christ our Lord, and Him alone. There's no other way. We'll celebrate next Sunday as we celebrate Jesus. We're going to celebrate the resurrected Savior. He came up out of that grave victorious, and He conquered death. And you know why He did that? For you. For me. For every human being in the world, He conquered death, the Bible says, for every man. For every man. You know what this means? He can save you now. How? The Bible declares in Romans chapter 10 that if we believe this with our heart and confess it with our mouth, we shall be saved. Amen. Paul says there's just two things that's keeping you from being saved. The one is, do you believe it in your heart? The second would be confessing with your mouth the Lord Jesus. And he says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. It's free to you, but it cost Christ His life. Right. Oh, friend, as we consider this parade of our Lord Jesus Christ, we see that He's the final, ultimate authority. And He is the ultimate authority. He alone will determine who has Christ and who doesn't. And those that call upon Christ, He welcomes them in. Those that reject Christ, He casts them, along with Satan, into the lake of fire. What have you done with Jesus? What have you done with Jesus? We see that He declared Himself to be the King of the Jews, and it got Him to the cross, which is exactly what He wanted. He wanted to die for you. Oh, what great love. He rose again, and in this, He declared that He is the Savior of the world. And we praise God that He's able to save now. If you need to be saved today, you can be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Would you bow your heads? Would you stand to your feet? It's a time of invitation. We as God's people, ought to be people who live by faith and trust in Him. This is our Savior. This is our Savior. We live by faith in our Savior. Oh, friend, sometimes we parade around and we talk about Christ, but we fail to live by faith. We fail to put feet to our faith. Maybe God is dealing with you in all of this. Where would you be? Would you be a Christian? Would you be afraid to parade the Lord? To wave the palm branches, to cast your coat down in the public eye with all the political eyes watching? With all the Jewish things going on? Would you be afraid to be right in the midst, right near Christ? Let's get real about this. Because when you go to the grocery store and the Holy Spirit says, "Will you share my message with somebody?" we shy away, don't we? Yeah. We have to live by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Some of us shy away when it comes to giving to the Lord. We worry and we fear, "Lord, I've got so many pressures on me financially. I can't begin to give to you." I want to ask you, would you be right there casting your clothes and casting your palm branches? Would you be right there with the Lord, willing to trust Him as He rides in? Would you be right there in the crowd with Him? Oh, friend, let's put some feet to our faith. Faith is looking unto Jesus. Let's trust the Lord in all these things. Some of you are trusting God with your children, as we studied this morning in our Sunday school hour. Are you ready to give to the Lord your children and to cast them? Maybe you need to gather them up, bring them to an altar, pray on them, and release them and dedicate them all. You probably did it when they were really small, but now you've got to dedicate them once again to the Lord and give them back to God. And just keep giving them and keep giving them. We're learning all of this from following Christ and parading Jesus. There's some here that don't know Christ as Savior. If you died, you don't know if heaven's your eternal home. Well, you can be saved today. He's ready to save now. He's ready to save now. How many say, "Pastor, would you pray for me? I need Christ as Savior." Would you lift your hand? Just make a show. Just lift your hand quickly. You say, "I need Christ as Savior. I don't know if I died today that I'd go to heaven, but I'd like to have that dealt with." Would you lift your hand and hold it high where I can see it? I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to come to you. I want to help you. Are there folks like that? God bless you. Are there others? You say, "I need Christ as Savior. I need Christ as Savior." Wonderful. Let us help you. In just a moment, we're going to have a time of invitation. Christians are going to come, and you can come right along with them. And we'll pray with you and help you to know Christ as Savior. You can call upon the Lord and be saved. There's folks that are coming to be baptized. You want to follow Christ. There's others that are coming that may want to be a part of this church and want to figure out how to become a member of this church. You come. We have counselors and workers down here. Some are coming with their children and giving them to God. Some are coming and they're bringing their heart and their life. They're giving their finances to God. Some are giving their anxiety to God. We're all coming, and we're all coming to the Lord, knowing that we'll find whatever we need in Him and Him alone. Let's respond to the Lord properly. We're going to sing hymn 178, but let's come. Let's come. Move now. Move now, Christians. Move now. If you need Christ as Savior, leave the hymn book alone and come now. Let's follow the Lord. Would you come? Be faithful. Do you need to be baptized? Do you need to dedicate yourself to the Lord? Do you need to bring your worries and fears to Christ? Cast them like the palm branches, like the coats in the streets. Give them to God and say, "Lord, they're yours. They're yours. You do with them as you will." Bring your children to God. Bring your family to God. Bring your marriage to God. Bring it all to the Lord. Let's parade the Lord. Folks are coming. If you need help at the altar, let us help you. If you need Christ as Savior, if you need Him as Savior, now is the time to respond. Let us help you. We want to help you. I'll take the Bible and show you how you can know for sure that heaven's your eternal home. Let us help you. Would you come? Would you come? Let's just be obedient to the Lord in this. The hymn is 178. Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord. Only trust Him. Let's lift our voices.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the mercy. Lord. And He will surely give you rest.
by trusting in His Word.
Only trust Him.
Only trust Him.
Only trust Him.
Only trust Him. Only trust Him now.
That's it. It's the place we must be.
He will save you. He will save you. He will save you now.
For Jesus shed His precious blood.
For Jesus shed His precious blood. Rich blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow.
Only trust Him.
Only trust Him. Only trust Him. Only trust Him now. He will save you. He will save you. He will save you.
Let's sing together. Yes, Jesus is the truth,
Jesus
the way
is
that
the
leads
truth,
you into rest.
That leads you into rest.
Believe in Him without delay.
Believe in Him without delay.
You are fully blessed.
Are fully
only
blessed.
Trust Him. Only trust Him.
Only trust Him. Only trust Him.
Only trust Him.
Only trust Him now. He will save you. He will save you. He will save you.
Come then and join this holy band.
Come then and join this holy band. And on to glory go.
To dwell in that celestial land.
In that celestial land
where joy is
immortal flow.
Let's lift our voices now.
Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you now.
Wonderful, wonderful. I'm so glad that our God declared Himself to be the ultimate authority, the King of the Jews, and the Savior of the world, aren't you? What a great entry our Lord made. He didn't do anything accidental. He does everything on purpose. And He's at work in your life, and He's done some things on purpose to bring you to Himself. And I want to encourage you today, if God is doing that work in your life, respond to Him. Just come to Him. Be right there amongst the crowd. And parade the Lord in your own life. Amen. Wonderful. We're going to meet together tonight. We meet a little early at 5:40 for a prayer meeting. We'll meet together at 6 o'clock. I hope you'll come and hear what the Lord has to say after His triumphal entry. And the lessons that He's teaching, I think it'd be good for all of us to hear them. I'm hoping I can deal with all of them, as there's quite a bit. But we're going to gather and pull the lessons out. I think it'll help us in our Christian life to live for the Lord. Let's pray together and we'll be dismissed. Our great God and Heavenly Father, we thank You for the opportunity to be together. We are awaiting, Lord, the celebration we'll have next Sunday, on this Resurrection Sunday. I pray that, Lord, You'd help us to work at inviting folks, bring us people, Lord, that we don't even expect. We will work diligently to have room, Lord, for folks. We pray that Thy hand of blessing be upon the entire meeting. It's in Thy precious name we pray. Be with us as we go our separate ways. Bring us back together tonight. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today. I am so glad that you have chosen to watch this service online. I pray that God has spoken to your heart. There's absolutely nothing greater than knowing that God from heaven reached down with His voice and spoke to you. The great question now is, what will your response be to God? If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then trust Him today. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. If you've never followed Christ in obedience through baptism, then be baptized. If you're not attending church, I challenge you Be a part of this church if you're in our local area. If not, find a church just like this one and become a member of it. I want to help you to do God's will with your life. And ultimately, I know that's what you want too. You want to do God's will. On our website, you'll find a number of ways in which our church can care for you spiritually. I would love to hear what God is doing in your life. Please stay in touch.